the Nintendo Entertainment System can arguably be considered the entire reason that video games in America did not crash and burn in the 80s with the video game crash, and almost the entire reason that I do what I do, why Jason makes this software, and why most of you watch our content. What if you want to go back and relive some childhood memories? Or what if you are new to video games, born within the last decade, or want a bit of a look back into video games that were? My name is Brad, and today on Unbroken Software Studio Tutorials, I'll walk you through how to set up the NES and Super Famicom systems, as well as the Japanese-only Famicom Disk System. I'll even show you how to apply fan-made translation patches to some of these Japanese and English games for non-native speakers, and how this applies to fan-made ROM hacks which either enhance, change, or completely rewrite entire games. And remember, if you haven't watched our other tutorials, they can all contain tips and tricks that apply to other systems. For example, the game patching in this episode can apply to other systems. So, first things first, like in our previous tutorials, tools, import, ROM files, and you're going to make sure to import all of your NES games and your Famicom Disk System games. Personally, I keep the NES and the Famicom Disk System games separately because they are technically separate systems. Think of this like the TurboGrafx-16 and the TurboGrafx-CD. Technically one unit, but two separate systems, two different games, that sort of thing. So like in previous tutorials, I'll be showing you how to use the NES cores in Retroarch, but you can add any emulator you want. Personally, for NES, Famicom, and Famicom Disk System games, I prefer Nestopia. So you'll type in Nestopia, you'll click here to go to the download page for Nestopia, download it if you don't have it, extract the RAR or ZIP if it exists, and then point it to the Nestopia.exe. And then under associated platforms, I have Nintendo Entertainment System, parentheses NES, parentheses, and then Famicom Disk System below that. So under the associated platforms for Retroarch, I have the load core command, and then I have it pointing towards the Nestopia libretro.dll. Then I have the command to load a custom config, and it's pointing towards the Nestopia underscore libretro.cfg. It looks like I don't have Famicom Disk System here in Retroarch, so let's go ahead and add that. So we'll double-click Famicom Disk System, and then as you may have saw when I started typing it, when I typed an F, it came up with a drop-down, so I can just click that. So now all I want to do is copy the NES line to the Famicom Disk System line. So I'll go to the NES, double-click in the default command line parameters, highlight, Control-C, go back down to the Famicom Disk System, double-click in the middle, and Control-V. Now, it may just paste the -L and the -C command lines, but sometimes it'll also copy the default emulator tab and the associated platform tab. So all you do is you highlight the end, and you highlight the beginning, and delete the excess, and then you're good to go. And then I'll sort by clicking the associated platforms with the arrow pointing up, and so it's in alphabetical order. Since I had Nestopia previously for Famicom Disk System and I want to change it to Retroarch, I'll click on a game, Control A to highlight all, right click, edit, and this will bring up the bulk edit wizard. Find emulator in the drop down field. Under value with the drop down menu, select Retroarch and then hit next, next. No, I don't need to make more changes. And it'll go ahead and change all of these games to use Retroarch instead of Nestopia. Even though it's actually just using the Nestopia core and Retroarch, I want to try to keep things centralized because I do believe that Retroarch does provide a better basis than most emulators and does provide you unilateral features across most systems that some emulators omit or don't have. I guess that's the same thing, isn't it? And with that, double-clicking Famicom Disk System game should immediately launch Retroarch. And because it's using the same Nestopia core, that's loud. Because it's using the same Nestopia core, it'll go ahead and boot and use the same custom config as well as the core that it should be using. And there it is. And of course, no tutorial would be complete by me if I didn't mention that the Famicom Disk System does need a BIOS file. It does need to be named disksys.rom, and you can find this by just Googling, but we're not gonna give you a link for this one. But it does need to be in your Retroarch system folder for the emulator to work, so please keep that in mind. Now, onto ROM patching. Now, I said this in the intro, you can use this for anything as simple as a sprite swap, so Sonic becomes Kirby. You can use it to make your own Mario ROM hacks, where the entire game is changed, the levels are all different to what you want them to be, or you can use it to translate Japanese to English, English to Spanish, or the more weird ones, English to Greek, English to Italian. I've seen them all. The best place that I know to find a lot of these patches are either from translation release group websites or from romhacking.net. This is the front page of romhacking.net. If you scroll down, you could see a good use for Contra on the NES, Revenge of the Red Falcon. So this is what would be considered just a ROM hack. Nothing is translated, but things have been changed. Enemies may be different, weapons may be different, levels may be different, story is different. So that is what more or less a ROM hack is. And these can be as simple as making a quote-unquote sequel to Contra, like this is probably doing. Or you can do total conversions and make something completely different by taking the Final Fantasy engine, but making a, let's say, Fallout RPG, but on the NES. Something like that is possible. They also do show off translations, so this is an NES game. I'm not going to pretend to read the Japanese, but it is Brave Fighter of the Sun Firebird in English, and they've translated this into from Japanese to English for users, so I could download this patch, have the ROM, and apply the patch to the ROM, and then it will suddenly all be in English. Of course, you can see dumps of, like I was saying, Sonic turned into Kirby. That was a real ROM hack, and that is sometimes usually a very simple ROM hack, or you can make Rockman 3 called Roll Chan 3. I mean, simple stuff, but they're fun. Or sorry, Roll Chan 5, Roll Chan 6. And then of course, so Ninja Gaiden, probably from either English or Japanese to Spanish. This here is saying what it's being translated into. So Earthbound and Ninja Gaiden never officially got translated into Spanish. So if you're a native Spanish speaker and you've never played Earthbound, now would be your chance to download the patch and be able to play it in your native language. But I see this a lot. German, Chinese, I've seen Greek, I've seen Czech, Polish is on here, English is on here, of course. I've seen many, many, many languages, and it's really awesome. Up here at the top, you can either hit translations, ROM hacks, or even go to homebrews if you want something a little bit more fan-made from the ground up. But today, I'll be taking a look at translations and ROM hacks. First things first, though, the most common patching file is a .ips patch file. So I'll have the ROM hacking utility page link in the description below so that you can download Lunar IPS. This is probably the best program that I've found to use IPS patches on ROMs. So for example, let's download Lunar IPS to my NES folder. We'll right click, extract here. Now you might notice that I have an IPS file already here, and normally it would be blank like this NES file saying that the IPS isn't associated to any program. But if we right click, open with, choose another app, Lunar IPS shouldn't be in your top list or in your more apps section. And if it is, that's good. Just go ahead and select always use this app to open IPS files and then select Lunar IPS. Or scroll all the way down if you're under Windows 8 or 10. Look for another app on this PC. Go over to where you have Lunar IPS downloaded. For this example, I did put it in our NES folder. You'll click on it, open. It'll use Lunar IPS for all IPS patches. There are different types of patches and patcher utilities. And the other one that I'm going to cover, because it is also kind of prevalent and people use it a lot, is the BPS patching system. Now, these usually don't come with programs to download, but the patches will be kind of in their own executable. We'll double-click the BPS executable. We'll open the game. In this case, it is Surikichi Senpai. And then it wants us to save a new copy of it so that we have our original file. So I'm going to click it to have the name populate down here. And then personally, what I like to do is I'll take the Japan in parentheses. I'll boil that back down to J. I'll put T plus E N to denote that it's a Japanese game translated into English. And that's just my personal take, but you can really name it whatever you want. For LaunchBox's sake, I do suggest putting this stuff in the parentheses, so that way when you import the game, J, T, plus EN is not imported as the game's name. Because if you try to scan Suri Kichi Senpai, Blue Marlin Hen, with the J plus the EN, it could probably throw things off. You really want to have just the game name as the name. So here, this patch came with Lunar IPS, the IPS patch, and then of course I supplied the Mega Man 3 ROM. This is a ROM hack for Mega Man 3 to change it to Mega Man 3 ICFE. And so since we've already associated a Lunar IPS EXE with the Lunar IPS patch, all you do is double click the patch. It's going to ask you for the game. You double click the game and the file was successfully patched. With IPS patches, I do suggest making a copy of the game and patching the copy of the game instead of patching the only version of it that you have. Because unlike BPS patching, IPS patching doesn't create a duplicate for you. So I'm going to name it Mega Man 3, and then I'm just going to tack on ICFE on the end. And then when I import this into LaunchBox, I'm going to have to manually search Mega Man 3, import the images and metadata, and then add ICFE back onto the end, because Mega Man 3 ICFE doesn't actually exist. It's a fan-made thing. Now, I've selected a Famicom Disk System game to show you that it is pretty much the same process no matter what system you're patching. So we're going to do the Nunzen version 1 English BPS patch. We're going to select the FDS game. I'm going to select the game again for renaming. Delete the Japan into J, T plus E, N. And then I'm going to actually add version 1 onto it. Since I know the version number of this patch, I'm going to add version 1 because they could come out with version 1.1 or 1.5 later in time. And if that happens, I want to know that I have got different versions. I'll probably then delete version 1, but you have to repatch from a base game. You can't usually patch on top of a patch. So if they do release an update, I'll have to repatch another clean ROM. I can't patch version 1 into version 2, for example. So it is always good to denote that it is different. So now that I've patched this game, Nunzen, I'm going to put it into my Famicom Disk System directory. We're going to go back to LaunchBox. Now, normally I would just import ROM files if I had more than one game to add, but since I only have one game to add, today we're going to do the single and manual addition to LaunchBox. So in the bottom right, click Add, and it'll bring up the Add Game box. I'm going to go ahead and copy the name Nunzen, and I'm going to put it into the game title here at the top. We're going to hit Browse, and go to the Famicom Disk System directory that I have set up. We're going to hit all files. We're going to go down to N. We're going to select Nunzen. We're going to go over to the emulation tab. We're going to select use an emulator to play this game. We're going to select Retroarch from the drop down menu. And then that really should be it. This is just more or less how you manually add a game. And then let's check if it has any metadata available. So we'll search. This game doesn't exist anywhere, which most Japanese games don't exist for the sources that we use for metadata, but in the future we are adding things like Giant Bomb and Mobi games to metadata scraping support, so the list of Japanese games will grow in time. Now I did something stupid. Let's go back to edit the ROM, and sometimes I forget this as well, and you really shouldn't forget this. When you're adding the game, you do need to set the platform. Otherwise, it won't go into any of these things on the left. So we do need to select Famicom Disk System. I can manually add the rest of these selections if I wanted to, but really, I'm only concerned for the Famicom Disk System platform. We'll hit OK again. LaunchBox will correct my mistake and actually add Nunzen to the Famicom Disk System selection on the left. Gotta make sure to do that, otherwise, essentially, this game won't have a platform. So the Famicom Disk System is going to go through its boot process. And then, there we are, Nunzen is loading. And it's not in Japanese, it's all in English. And I have no idea what this game is, but there you go, it is translated. But there you go, that is how you add Nintendo Entertainment System games, Famicom Disk System games, and find patches for these games if you want to change them from their default language, or if you want to play around with Mega Man 3, maybe you've beat it 4 or 5 times and you want to play a new version of it, well, someone might have created one for you that you might like. So that is how you find the patches, apply the patches, and then actually re-import the games back into LaunchBox. Remember, my name is Brad, and if you guys like the sound of my voice or you liked this tutorial and it helped you out, please give this video a thumbs up and comment in the comment section below if you have any questions about anything that I went over today. A link to my channel will be in the card system in the top right. Click the exclamation point, it'll pop down, and you just click to my channel and it should open my channel in a new tab. I do a lot of gaming content, so if that sounds like your cup of tea or you like my videos on my channel, please give me a subscribe. I would greatly appreciate it. Remember, freaks and geeks, play more games, and we'll see you next time on Unbroken Software Studio Tutorials. Have a good day!